A beautiful hymn indeed from the United Methodist Church of Korea. A wonderful tune by one of the pastors of the UMC in Seoul, Korea. Come now, Prince of Peace, and welcome to Pauline United Methodist Church in our parish worship service for the first Sunday in Advent. Yes, it is Advent, and I must admit I was a little surprised with the white stuff in the ground this morning. I wasn't quite ready, and I also learned that you don't go on old Route 55 between Pokwag and Pauling when it's snowing, especially when there's an RV across the road at the top of the hill. So it was a mess, but I was fortunate enough to escape backwards and get back on Route 55 proper this morning. Brothers and sisters, let us center our hearts and minds as we begin our worship on this first Sunday in Advent.
Please join me in our call to worship. As November will end, December will begin. We find our beginning and our ending in God. Month after month, our God attends us and supports us. For God's company, we offer thanks and praise. Let us worship the God who gives us Jesus Christ. God who is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the living one and our Redeemer, now and forever. Please join in our opening prayer. Merciful God, you sent your messengers, the prophets, to preach repentance and prepare the way for our salvation. Give us the grace to heed their warnings and forsake our sins, that we may greet with joy the coming of Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our opening hymn is O Come, Emmanuel. The words will be on the screen. Jeremiah. Every time I read Jeremiah, it feels like he's shouting, like he wanted his voice to carry for thousands of years so that future generations would hear it. So hear the words from Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is righteousness.
The New Testament lesson is 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verses 9 to 13. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy that we feel before our God because of you? Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you face to face and restore whatever is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you, and may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, just as we abound in love for you. And may he so strengthen your hearts in holiness that you may be blameless before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all his saints.
It is Advent, and we are in an altar that is draped with the color of the season, which is purple. And that color will remain with us up until Christmas Eve. We are also featuring and reinstalling, if you will, our Advent wreath. And the Advent wreath is an important reminder of four of the great aspects of the ministry of Jesus Christ: hope, joy, peace, and love. And each week we will light a candle remembering one of these aspects of Christ's ministry that is so important as we remember yet again the coming of Christ so long ago to deliver the message of God to the people of the earth. So I invite you to join me in the blessing of this Advent wreath in your bulletin, and let us read responsibly this blessing. Christ came to bring us salvation and has promised to come again. Let us pray that we may always be ready to welcome him.
Come, Lord Jesus.
That the keeping of Advent may open our hearts to God's love.
Come, Lord Jesus.
That the light of Christ may penetrate the darkness of sin.
Come, Lord Jesus.
That this wreath may constantly remind us to prepare for Christ's coming.
Come, Lord Jesus.
That the Christmas season may fill us with peace and joy as we strive to follow the example of Jesus.
Come, Lord Jesus.
Loving God, your church joyfully awaits the coming of its Savior, who enlightens our hearts and dispels the darkness of ignorance and sin. Pour forth your blessings upon us as we light the candles of this wreath. May their light reflect the splendor of Christ, who is Lord forever and ever. Amen. I'm going to ask our worship team, Holly and Grace, to join me as we light the candle of hope. And thank you for dressing the altar for this wonderful season. Thank you for your extra work. As they light one of the purple candles, let us pray the lighting of the candle of hope together. Let's pray. We light this candle as a symbol of Christ, our hope. May the light sent from God shine in the darkness to show us the way of salvation. O come, Emmanuel. Amen. And I'll ask you to stand for the reading of the gospel lesson, which today comes from the book of Luke, chapter 21. The coming of the Son of Man. There will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint from fear and the foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to take place, stand up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Then Jesus told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never leave you. So be on guard that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation or drunkenness and worries of this life, and that day does not catch you unexpectedly like a trap. For it will come upon all who live on the face of the earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all those things that will take place, and you will then stand before the Son of Man. The word of God for the people of God. Please be seated. I think it's in my own personal history and tradition that I get excited around Advent. I really get enthused about this season, the newness of what's happening. This is the beginning of a new church year. This is the first Sunday of this liturgical year. And we start the clock over again in anticipation of the coming of Christ. It's a feeling of newness, a feeling of hope in our hearts. We've lit the candle of hope today. And what is hope? Hope is a feeling. Hope is a connotation of looking ahead, of wanting something to happen that hasn't happened yet. Hope is wanting and expecting something good to come our way. It's a feeling that something that's desired can be achieved. Something good is going to happen. Hope is a looking forward with a desire and a confidence. Hope is positive. Now, I confess that there are certain things that are also going on right now at this time of year that add to my hope and excitement that happens. This is the time of year. In fact, this very day is my brother's birthday. So happy birthday, Nick. My brother lives in Roanoke, Virginia. And he's 100 years old. And I was able to talk to him a couple of times this week. And this coming Saturday is Diane and my 42nd anniversary of marriage. Thank you. And so we always treat ourselves to a nice dinner out somewhere, and we finally made it after years and years of saying that we have to do this. We're finally going to have lunch at the Culinary Institute in Hyde Park.
Yay.
So we finally were able to get a reservation. So, and this time of year, next week is my daughter's birthday. And so all these things, you know, kind of give me a little extra personal lift at this time of year. And in our church, we're doing things. We're talking about traditions of the season. We're talking about a cookie walk. We're starting a book study revolving around Christmas and Advent and all things good this afternoon. And we're going to be greening our sanctuary. We're turning them into the decor of Christmas over the next few days in all of our parish churches. So when I reminded myself and read the fact that the Bible study is using a text called All Things Good, I said, yes, all things are good. This is a good time of year where so many things are good. And our prophecy that Mark read from Jeremiah today reminds us of this. We heard these words, a branch of the family of David will spring up and bloom, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. It's a foretelling of the coming of the Messiah. Now, both Jeremiah and his buddy Isaiah were prophets that foretold the coming of Christ many, many centuries before it happened. Well, at least six centuries anyway. We need to remember that Jeremiah was called by God and prophesied a number of things that were going to happen and did happen. He lived around 625 BC, and he was a prophet during the very short range of four or five of the last kings of Israel. He was a prophet that foretold what was going to be happening in Judah and in Jerusalem. He even foretold the oppression that was yet to come as the forces of the Babylonian Empire were getting more and more militant and were taking over more and more territory. And he would remind people that they would have to go through oppression, but that after that, they would be restored again because of a Messiah that would come from the house of David. Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will once again live in safety, and it will be called the Lord is our righteousness. Now, we celebrate the coming of Christ in so many ways, and one of the ways that we'll be doing this, and we even started today singing carols and songs of the season. Yeah, you remember this one that we're going to probably sing later in December? Lo, how a rose e'er blooming from a tender stem is sprung, of Jesse's lineage coming, as those of old have sung. All right, that's one of the carols in our hymn book. And I must have sung that song 500 times in my life, right? And I know Helen has sung it more than 500 times.
Watch.
And, you know, 798 to be exact. But then I looked again of Jesse's lineage coming, and I had to go back and remind myself that Jesse was David's father. Jesse was the father of King David. And Jesse's father was Obadiah, who has a book in the Bible. Okay. So that's what that means. This is the prediction from Jeremiah that from the lineage of David and Jesse, there will come someone who will execute peace and justice, the Messiah. So it is the season of hope. We have lit the candle of hope today, and we're here in 2021. And I think that God has given us things to be hopeful about this year. We're here again. We're seeing each other. We're lifting our hearts and voices to the Lord in 2021, and we didn't do much of that in 2020. We are starting to feel some of the emergence of the oppression and depression of this pandemic that we continue to live through. It started 21 months ago, and we're continuing to struggle with it and find it a challenge. But we're starting to see signs of hope. We're starting to see things happen. Many of us enjoyed a Thanksgiving dinner with friends and family without masks, without 6 feet of separation, and feeling a little bit more normal again. We live in a blessed area of the country in many ways. And one of the ways is that where we live, we have been able to, and most people have chosen to, be vaccinated against this dread virus that we've been battling. Okay? And we're not out of the woods yet. We still have variants. We still have other things that are frightening us, but we're kind of moving ahead. We see some progress. We see some hope. And I had a personal feeling to express that my hope, one of my hopes, is that those who, for whatever rationale, have not accepted what the vaccine can do, those who may have come to, that those people may come to an unselfish realization of how this medicine can protect other people, can protect humankind. And that they come around and have the same hope. Because we know that this medicine can help prevent severe illness and death. I also hope that those people that continue to isolate themselves, to choose to be sequestered, even though they may be vaccinated and even though they have taken other precautions, will have God ease their fears so that they can gradually come and live fuller lives again. The candle of hope, it burns brightly for all of us this Advent season. And I think it's burning brightly to focus on and remind us of the miracles that Jesus has performed, and that the coming of the Christ child again will bring that hope to many, especially those who have not known God and not known his son, Jesus Christ. Now we're getting into the season. We're going to hear things like, it's time to put Christ back in Christmas again. And we have heard these phrases for a long time, for many, many years. But it's a great time to think about doing that, isn't it? It's the perfect time for us to ask for forgiveness, to repent, to turn and look in the mirror and admit that in our own heart that we want Christ to be the central part of our Christmas in 2021. The truth is for me that preparing for Christmas is trying to focus myself constantly on Jesus. And if I don't do that, if I don't focus on Jesus and what he means to me, and I focus on the secular traditions and the things that get exploited in the media, things that cost too much, more money than I have or my family has, and certainly many other families don't have. But the focus, as we look in the mirror, on Christ and Christ's meaning to us. So how do we, as followers of Jesus Christ, make sure that we're focused and return the purpose of Christmas over to Jesus? How do we prepare for his birth and coming again? It's an important question. It's a personal question. Can we take a breath? Can we pray? And can we recenter ourselves anew toward living in hope and taking on a life of Christ in all that we do? And we have help. God will help us. We have a divine assist here. And it begins with God's ever-loving grace and love for us. His mercy is something that we can feel inside. Something that if we turn away from the challenges and things that are bad, and we remember why Christ came to earth all of those years ago, we can feel a joy inside. We can feel a rekindling of hope inside. Some label this feeling as a conversion, as a grasping and a following of Jesus. Some call it baptism by the Holy Spirit, being born again. John Wesley called it blessed assurance. Whatever we call it, it's time for us to reach out and grab it. We know it when it happens in our hearts. It's a feeling that we have. It causes us to see the kinds of lives we live, especially the lives that are commercial and that focus on other things besides loving one another, loving God, and trusting our neighbors. So if we want to remain in Christ in this season of Advent, we have to work at it. We have to give ourselves to the notion and the joy of the coming of Christmas and the coming of that life again, that feeling of wonder, that feeling of love. We have to work at it. That's why our church year has a season that starts again. It starts today. Advent is the beginning of the Christian year. And why do we have it again? Because we're human and we need to be reminded of the wonder and the power and the gifts that God has given us. We're human and we need to be reminded. There's an old hymn lyric that I saw this week that was updated by a minister in a posting that says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. Turn back toward God, because heaven is right around the corner. Turn back toward God, because the possibility of deep and abiding joy is very near. Turn back toward God, because Jesus is coming. Turn back toward God to free yourselves from false expectations that are peddled by those who lie and often are peddled by those who are out to make nothing but an almighty dollar. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." The kingdom of heaven is a way of living that Jesus comes again to show us this season. It is a way of living according to God's plan and his vision for our creation and the blessings of this life that we worship week in and week out. It is living a life as Jesus lived himself and has taught us to live. It is living a life of hope. To the extent that we are able to give our hearts back over to Jesus, that is the extent to which we enter and re-enter the kingdom of heaven in this life, now. And the only way we can live it is by turning and turning and turning back again to face Jesus as he comes again to greet us. Don't we want the kingdom of heaven to be more in our lives now and more than what happens just when we die? I think we do. Don't we want the coming of the Son of Man to be what's happening now while we live and why we can share it with others who are living? I certainly hope so. And I hope you do too. Amen. Please stand and share the peace and love and hope of Jesus Christ with one another. Let us go forth and remember the candle of hope. Let it burn brightly in our hearts as we move forward into this Advent season. Let us be Christ to all that we meet, especially the stranger that we have yet to meet. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst us and remain with us always. Go in peace, and may the peace of God stay in your hearts forever. Amen.